Just want to share a few things. God's good. You know, he's promised me a lot of things that now I'm aware of because I took Jesus into my heart. And a lot of good things are happening. I had a job interview this morning for a new position of work. I believe it's a door that the Lord opened for me to go through. It's going to help me in many ways, not only to grow professionally, but also help me financially. Not that I'm struggling, but based on some things that I am kind of seeing that might be happening in my future. My brother, I've shared this recently, his wife has been interviewing for jobs with the school systems in Texas. And every time she goes to an interview, they're like, yeah, well, no, we brought you here for this position, but we're actually going to interview you for this one, which turns out to be better. Well, she already went through the whole process, and they are told her that there's going to be a position that they would like to see if they can offer her in a particular school. But the schedule, she'll have to be there 30 minutes before their kids get to school. And she'll get out 30 minutes after they're done. So she's worried about that. Well, the Lord opened a door for the exact same position opened up in the school that her kids go to. Wow. So she's gonna go talk to, I don't know if it's the superintendent or the principal, to see if they can consider her for that position. I'm believing that that's something that the Lord set in motion for her not to have to worry about those scheduling conflicts.
Amen.
You know, he's good. I was going to talk today about pride, but I said, you know what, I'm not going to do that because I don't want to sound like a Debbie Downer. I'm just going to be thankful and share good things that are happening and just remember that he's good. What he said he's going to do is going to happen. Many good things are happening. To the people of this church, you know, BB came back before what was not foreseen, but established before. You know, we all know that that was something that God did. All these invitations that we're getting to go to all these different churches in this region, this is not just coincidence. I know it's that the Lord wants us to be there for a reason. So let's just continue to praise him for his goodness.
Yes.
And just remind ourselves that what he said he's going to do, just stand on that promise because it's going to happen.
Amen.
Yes.
That's
Amen.
My little nugget of wisdom today.
Yes.
So, with that, if anyone would like to share testimony, prayer requests, Suzanne sends her thanks for all the prayers.
Amen.
She says that her father on Monday took a drastic turn for the better. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if he's already home or if he will be within the next few days, but she did say that he was gonna come back home.
Yeah. He's in a rehabilitation.
Okay. We will see him dancing some moringa pretty soon.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
Anyone has anything they want to share? Yes, Tammy.
Dan had a visitor on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And
to the store? No, I'm kidding.
And I was telling Jody that, you know, it sometimes, I mean, I realize we get revelation all the time, and I'm grateful and so appreciative that I go to this church and know what I know. But sometimes someone comes across your path who maybe went to Sunday school when they were kids. Maybe they go to church once in a while. But it's so religious and denominational that when you have a conversation, it dawns on you how much revelation we have.
Yes.
And how much they have to receive.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, it's exciting. But it makes you just keenly aware of how much we know. And so I just pray for wisdom that when we cross those people,
yes.
gives us patience and wisdom. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you kind of noticed on Sunday, I was getting a little frustrated because things were not working properly. And it was, I was feeling a little overwhelmed because,
baptism by fire.
Yes. Yeah, because that was the first time that I had to do everything, run the sound booth, do the scriptures, do the DVD, lead worship, and all that stuff. But it was good,
yes,
because
yes.
Although I was a little frustrated, and I took a step back, and I said, Lord, you know, you're in charge here, so I'm not going to worry. I was at no point at all, I was nervous that I was going to screw up.
Yeah.
So, and also Sunday marked my 11-year anniversary that I landed in Des Moines International Airport for the first time when I got here. So,
that's the parade they're having.
Yep. Just to celebrate.
Celebrate.
Yours truly. Anyway.
Yeah.
I'm at home.
Yes.
And I know where I'm from. I love where I'm from, and I'm really proud to be where I'm from. But to me, this is my house.
Yes.
Yeah.
So.
Yep.
Amen. That's awesome.
Yeah. Yes, Mike.
Let's pray for James' situation, his house with pests, all the things. Pests that are seen, and I'll call out the pests that are unseen.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, I got an email today from a person who was part of the House of Prayer that started up when Cindy and I were still dating. That House of Prayer separated, actually split up into a couple different places, and doing House of Prayers at several different places now. Kingdom House of Prayer, this House of Prayer here, and another House of Prayer on the west side of Des Moines. Was invited to a meeting next Thursday night, a week from tomorrow, involving the eldership of the city of Des Moines, governmental situation. So they said, church is not going to be the same as it's been. Things got to change, and this government, this God government or spiritual government, has to be aligned and ready to take on the harvest that's coming. And when Tammy was talking about it's coming,
mm-hmm.
I understand that. Now, this church, she's never been here, this lady's never been here, but if she did, she would understand the dynamic of what's going on here.
Yes.
Okay? And this, I believe I will go to this because I need to share that there is what she's talking about already started here.
All right.
Okay.
Amen.
So, and just people are trying to get lined up with what God wants to do. And,
right.
And I mean, you know, where's everybody at tonight? You know, here. You know,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's because their eyes aren't seeing and their ears aren't hearing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm going to go speak to it and show them a week from tomorrow night as I meet with this group of people. One of them is Rick Arrowwood, Kingdom House of Prayer. He's been here a couple times, and he understands what's going on here. He just can't put it into words.
Yeah.
So I pray that the Lord will give me words to speak of the governmental authority that this place, the spiritual government authority or kingdom governmental authority that this place has been given, and how it will start manifesting into the world, and the world will start seeing the true love and grace of the Lord.
Yes.
And bring in the revelation of what He wants to do instead of what people are trying to put together.
Right.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, well, let's stand. Let's thank our Heavenly Father tonight. Father, we thank you for bringing us together here in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness, for your promises, Lord, that we know that are coming to pass in our lives.
Lord, you are worthy.
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 Fresh anointing. Fresh anointing, Lord.
So we just gotta have this thing so deep in us that no matter what he throws our way,
certain way and to thank him for it. Mm-hmm. And within an hour, she said, "My guys, just like you said, I went and this thing left my body just the way it is,
oh,
and
yeah.
I feel fine now, perfectly fine." And I begin to see other things now in this spirit world that the lies of our natural eyes are out there.
Yeah.
Everything we see pretty much is a lie.
That's
now.
Right.
We're going to see it in the spirit.
Yeah.
And we're going to take hold of what has been lost and take it back by God's word.
Yeah.
See it the way he did in the beginning.
Yes.
It's perfect. Everything is.
Yes.
It's healing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Financial gains. Everything that's been robbed from us,
yes.
We're going to take it back.
Yes.
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 Thank you. finished work, Lord. That your grace covers all, Lord.
Thank you. praise, God. We love you tonight, Jesus. Thank you for your precious promises, Lord. And we just say yes and amen to each and every one of them, Lord, and declare that they shall come to pass even as you have said. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the testimonies tonight. Thank you, Lord, for the words of encouragement that come from you through your people. We just bless you tonight, Lord, and look forward to all that you're doing in our personal lives and in the lives of the church. And we just bless you right now and thank you in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise
amen.
The Lord.
Praise God. Thank you, worship team. Praise God. Good work as always. Amen. And I'm going to go right to the word here so we can have an early night out, hopefully. Praise the Lord. The Lord to have his way. Praise God. I'm going to begin with a couple of verses of scripture from Psalms chapter 51. I'd like you to go to Psalms 51, verses 16 and 17. Praise the Lord. Praise God. God is good. Amen. Psalms 51, 16 and 17. Praise God. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Praise the Lord. So, you know, when religious people screw up and mess up their lives or somebody else's lives, their response is to try to make up for it by performing better. Mm-hmm. And in order to show God how sorry they are. So they try to make this great sacrifice. Praise God. You know, I remember people going on long fasts and depriving themselves of, you know, entertainment or anything. I mean, just anything. Because they screwed up and got into a mess, and then they think that somehow if they do a lot of good stuff now, what they think is good, it's going to make God fix it all. Everything will be fine. Amen? But God's looking for a change of heart inwardly.
Yes.
He's looking for something like, as was said here tonight, deep. Yeah. Something that goes deep inside of us. A faith, a belief, an expectation of God's goodness. Amen? God's looking for this change of heart inwardly before there's ever any kind of change of outward behavior. In fact, if it doesn't happen that way, which is where we've screwed up religiously, is we've given people all kinds of rules and tell them, behave like this, don't do this, don't say that, don't do that, when nothing ever happens inside. Now, you can modify the behavior, but nothing has really changed in the person.
Right.
So God's more interested in the change of heart than he is about the outward behavior.
Yes.
Humanly, we're still looking at behavior all the time, trying to measure people and judge people and categorize them and everything else, and God is looking at the heart. Now, if you've been born again, your heart is perfect before God.
Yes.
He's not talking about a blood pump here. He's talking about the spirit, the essence of who we are, the reality of who and what we really are. Amen? And the spirit of legalism is a spirit of self-sufficiency, and it's ultimately, it's pride. It's arrogance. Now, people that are religious don't ever think that way. They think, no, I'm not proud. I'm not arrogant. But in fact, they're constantly trying to give themselves a sense of worth and value by what they do.
Yep.
And they measure everybody else by what they're doing or not doing rather than ever seeing that something has inwardly taken place. So the Apostle Paul, who, by the way, was an ex-Pharisee, he said a Pharisee of Pharisees, so this is like a religious fanatic on steroids, and he said about himself, he recognized that there's a need for this very thing to become an ongoing process, even in his own life. Let's look at this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 11. And I don't think actually you could find anybody or a better description then of a religious person or a legalistic type of person than Paul. And here's what he said. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And here we've got something. Amen. And we have this treasure in earthen vessels so that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us.
Right.
So that what changes, what has transformed us, isn't necessarily what we're doing, but who we are. And that came from God. It didn't come from anything we've done or could ever do, for that matter.
Right.
We are troubled on every side. I mean, it can say praise the Lord. I mean, it happens to all of us. And yet not distressed. We're perplexed, but not in despair.
Exactly. Yes.
Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down,
yes,
but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. Now, understand this. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. We died with Christ. We were buried with Christ. That's what we're supposed to remember. Amen. And the reason for that is it's the only way that the life of Jesus can be manifest in us. It isn't ever manifested by the works that we do. It's manifested by the Spirit of God that has come alive in us because we have died, amen, with Christ. Praise the Lord. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Now, he's not talking about we're dying, that we're being killed, but we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake. In other words, we die to the flesh. We die to our own will, our own behavior, our own what we do. Amen. So that the life of Jesus might be made manifest. Because the life of Jesus is not manifest necessarily in good works. I can do some good works,
yeah,
but that doesn't manifest Jesus necessarily. It really more often will draw attention to me.
Yeah.
But if I'm led by the Spirit, amen, it may not always look like it ought to look, but it'll always produce what he says it'll produce. Amen. He'll be manifested in some way or another. Hallelujah. Amen. James 4 and 6. He says that God is opposed to the proud. Amen. But he gives grace to the humble.
Yeah.
Amen. He giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Now humility is drawing near to God. Humility isn't saying I'm just a worthless, no good, you know, whatever. But humility is drawing God, recognizing that our complete need for him,
yeah,
is everything in our life, amen?
Yeah.
As well as our need for brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Amen? I heard, let me just say, if you're down, if you go there, go here to Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, Roberto. But if you or I are down, we need to get four of our crazy friends to lift us up.
Yeah.
Amen? That's what this is all about. That's what this coming together is, whether it's us or 100 people or 5,000 people or whatever. Amen? Because, then again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. And they came unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy. Guy couldn't get up, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. When they had broken it up, they let down the bed where the sick of the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Before he dealt with anything else, he just said, everything's good between you and me. Praise the Lord. And this is a guy, like all of us, that he couldn't help himself at that point. He was wore out. He was frustrated. He was, in this case, he had a palsy. But for us, it can be anything. There are times when you just get overwhelmed and you need some crazy friends, because that's what the world thinks. We're all nuts anyway because of the things that we say and what we do and so on and so forth. But you need to get some of your crazy friends and they'll lift you up. They'll get you, amen, to a place where you can receive from the Lord, where God can speak to you, where God can deliver, amen, and do what only God can do, amen?
Amen?
You cannot be proud, independent, self-reliant, that spirit has to die.
Yes.
That's the spirit that has to be put to death.
Yes.
This sense that I can fix it, you know, I can do it. I can, if I just pray long enough, if I just fast long enough, I'll be perfect, you know, I'll be everything I got to be. Look at this in John chapter 15, verse 5. I am the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Philippians 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Now, without Christ, I can't do anything, because unless I'm connected to the vine, I don't produce. But if I am, there's nothing I can't do.
Right.
I can do all things. Amen? Mm-hmm. See, that's the point. And that's the difference between religion and relationship, is that we are spiritually bankrupt without Christ.
Yes.
You're not going to do anything spiritually through your own effort. You're just not going to. It's impossible to do. You can do some good stuff, but it doesn't make it spiritual just because it's good.
Right.
Amen? Romans chapter 7, verse 18. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. Again, Paul's talking. Now, how many of you, I mean, we don't want to admit this. So when our flesh is, you know, our flesh, what are we surprised with? You know, I mean, why are we so shocked? There's nothing good in my flesh.
No.
My flesh didn't get born again.
No.
I'm born again of the Spirit.
Right.
Now, ultimately, my flesh will begin to more closely resemble the Spirit, but not because I'm making it do stuff, just simply because it will just do what it does.
Yeah.
Amen? So, you know, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing.
That's right.
I want to do the right thing,
but
how am I supposed to do it? I don't know. Not, I don't know how to do it spiritually in the flesh.
Yeah.
Amen? Legalism is the flesh trying to live a Christian life.
Yeah.
That's the definition, actually, of religion.
Yeah.
It's your flesh trying to be Christian.
Yeah. Yes.
Now, you might get some other people to give you a hand for your good behavior. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
They might applaud your flesh,
but
it is a total failure
in
the eyes of God.
Right.
Praise God. Your good effort, your good works of the flesh do not impress God.
No.
It might impress the deacon. It might impress some other religious person, but it doesn't impress God. It's so counterintuitive. It's so everything that we've been taught.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Right.
Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. What things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss. See that? All? Mm-hmm. All things. But lost for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 11 through 15. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. So it's futile to rely on our own fleshly resources, amen, to live out Christianity. It can't be done. It is an impossibility as far as God's concerned. That's what Jesus was driving at when we read in the Beatitudes about him saying things that are, it looks like it's the end. You know, let's just go there. Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 9. Blessed is the man who's at the end of his rope, you know, right? Blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they'll be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. So what's he saying is that when we get to where we recognize we don't have the ability to do these things, we get close to God. We're depending on God, which is what Jesus was asking for. God isn't out to make our life miserable. God is not trying to make us wore out and tired and frustrated. He wants us to live life to the full. You don't have to go there, but John 10:10 says, he came to give us life,
yep,
and that more abundantly.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
All right, Genesis chapter 32, 24 through 31. Genesis 32, verses 24 through 31. Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that, he prevailed not against him. He touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. He said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. And he said unto him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed. And Jacob asked him and said, tell me, I pray thee, thy name. And he said, wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name? And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. And as he passed over Peniel, the sun rose upon him, and he halted upon his thigh. Praise the Lord. So up until this time, Jacob had been a deceiver. He had tricked and manipulated people. Now, recognize this. It was the will of God for him to have preeminence over his brother who was older than him.
Yeah.
But it wasn't up to him to do that.
Right.
So Jacob deceives his brother to get what God had promised. Mm-hmm. But God had a way of doing it that Jacob didn't have to do it that way, but that's just the way he was. That it was him trying to make things happen, him trying to do stuff his own way, right? And now he's clinging to the Lord,
yeah,
right? He's relying on him at Peniel. And that word Peniel means the face of God. He'd come face to face with God. He became a new man because of that encounter. And no longer is he called Jacob the deceiver, but now God changes his name to Israel, which literally translates God fights. You don't have to fight anymore. God fights for you.
Yes.
Amen? Praise the Lord. So John chapter 12. Verses 24 through 25. John 12, 24 through 25. Verily, verily, I say unto you, and I might remind you back to the Jacob thing, when Jacob became infirmed, or when he wasn't as strong to where he had to depend on God, he did depend on God. As long as he had the fleshly ability to do things and manipulate things, he was going to. That's the only reason for this meeting or this encounter with God, is to show us that we just need to depend on God. This isn't about our strengths or our talents or our gifts. It's about the more we depend on God, the greater God is able to operate in our life. So here he says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. That's us.
Yes.
We need to die, not to bad behavior, but to self-effort.
Yes.
Not to, you know, moral failure, but die to the flesh trying to operate and trying to do things that it is incapable of doing.
Yes.
If it's not based on the silver and gold, it ain't amounting to anything anyway. It's just wood and hay and stubble.
Yeah.
Anything the flesh produces is going to burn up.
Right.
No matter how good it is, if it's produced by the flesh, it's just not going to last.
Right.
Only what Christ does is eternal.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So he that loveth his life shall lose it. That's the context in which that's being spoken. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. There's a huge difference between a man or a woman walking in legalism and ones that are walking in freedom.
Yes.
It's hard for the religious people to grasp, but it's the way Jesus intended it. We're supposed to be happy. We're supposed to be free. We're supposed to be enjoying life. We're supposed to be living not with a sense of guilt and shame for whatever we didn't do right or did intentionally wrong. We're supposed to be living in the freedom of what Christ has purchased for us. We're not even supposed to be thinking about the other stuff. We're supposed to be dead, amen, to all of it, amen. Sin consciousness shouldn't even exist in us. Every time we say, oh, I shouldn't have done that, we're sin conscious. And Jesus said we should be no more sin conscious. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ, amen, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Praise the Lord. Amen. So legalism enslaves us. It makes us afraid. It makes us fear that we're not doing enough to please God. That's the flesh. That's what the flesh is. Amen. Being led by the Spirit is being guided by God into intimacy, acceptance, and dependence on the Lord. That's what he wants. Guidance is what God gives us. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It leads us and guides us into all truth. Amen. So guidance. At the end of the word guidance is the word dance. And doing God's will is a lot like dancing. Now, I've told everybody before, but since it's just us, praise the Lord. The way we were raised, my mother was determined that we would have some kind of art and culture in our life. Yeah, I know. But nevertheless, so every one of us kids had to play an instrument, and we all had to learn to dance. We had to take dancing lessons. As I've said before, fortunately for me, I just took contemporary dance, which means I never had to wear a pair of tights. Hallelujah. Or flip or flop or anything else. I learned like ballroom dance, the contemporary dances of the time, which was in the late 50s, early 60s. So, I learned the foxtrot and some of those things. Now, yeah, I know. And I played an instrument. I played the baritone. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows what a baritone is. That's why I played it. Because you can play really bad and nobody ever knows. Hallelujah. Because the tubas and the trombones always overwhelm the baritones, praise God. But you had to pick one, so I picked one, and that was mine. So I learned a little bit about dancing simply because I had to. And when two people try to dance, only one can lead.
That's right.
Because if you get two people trying to lead, amen, nothing feels right. Nothing works right. The movements don't flow with the music. Amen. Everything's jerky. Everything's uncomfortable. Everything's awkward. But when one person relaxes and lets the other person lead, both of those bodies begin to flow with the music.
Yeah.
One gives gentle cues, a little squeeze here, a little nudge there, kind of a forewarning of what the next move's going to be, which direction you're going to go, if you're slowing down, speeding up, whatever it might be. And it's as if the two become one body. That's the idea behind it.
Yes.
That's the reasoning for it.
Yeah.
And to dance, it takes surrender.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a willingness and an attention from one person and gentle guidance and skill from the other. So one has to be surrendered and willing to do however the other leads. Amen? When you see G in guidance, think of God. Because followed by the G, or God, in guidance, is you and I. God lets you and I dance. He does all the work. All we got to do is hang on and enjoy the ride. Amen. Let God lead. Life is really a rhythm. It's a dance in a way. And it only works when you're letting God lead.
Amen.
And you and I just surrender,
yes,
and go with the flow. Yes. Praise the Lord. Yes. Trust Him. Lean not to your own understanding, and He'll give you life.
Yes.
Not rules, not laws, but life.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Let's dance home tonight. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. That's how.
That reminds me about 5 years ago when I got that vision, kind of danced across the TV screen, and God was talking to me and said to dance with me like He used to dance with Uncle Frank. And I used to stand on my Uncle Frank's feet, and he danced.
Yeah.
He danced all over the house. But
yeah.
That's the same thing. Just,
yes.
I trusted Him to lead me in dancing.
Amen. Yes. And that's what God's saying. Life is a dance. It's rhythms, it's ups and downs, it's forwards, backwards, sideways. I mean, things are always happening. But we don't always hear the music that we're dancing to. You know what I'm saying? This is what Toby was talking about. Seeing in the Spirit, hearing in the Spirit. That's when the Holy Spirit can really take over and lead us and guide us into all truth. That's when God takes the lead and you and I just go along for the dance.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Just enjoy the music of your life. Hallelujah. And let God lead you. Hallelujah. And good things are going to happen. Good things are going to happen. When you get a religious person, a legalist, in that situation, they can't be led because they're trying to lead.
Right.
And it always becomes awkward,
sure,
and jerky,
yes,
and dysfunctional.
Yes.
But when we let go and let God, as the old cliche goes,
yes,
something beautiful begins to happen.
Yes.
Art actually starts to be expressed,
yes,
in our lives without us doing anything,
yeah,
other than just trusting Him.
Yes.
Amen. That's the key, hallelujah, to being led by the Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless all of you tonight. Praise the Lord. Just enjoy the dance.
Yes.
Listen to the music. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Amen.